Next presentation will be given by Victor Johansson, and he will talk about biomass in the electricity system, complement to variable renewables or carbon sink.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for the introduction. I think we can answer a few of the last questions that Glenn pointed out, what, how the integration of BECCS in the electricity system could work out. So in this, we've looked at a few different roles of biomass, and what, some of them include negative emissions. And it's a work I've done together with Marie-Lise Lettver and Lisa Göransson, and we call it Biomass in the Electricity System, Complement to Variable Renewables or Carbon Sink. As you all know, biomass is a limited resource, and as many have pointed out earlier, the transport sector will be one of the most difficult, maybe. So, and whereas lots of different sectors are going to need this limited resource, negative emissions, as well as dispatchable source of electricity, are two major reasons to look at the biomass from the electricity sector's perspective. So what we actually wanted to look at with this is, for example, how much biomass do we need? How much can we use? Is a difficult question. So we went back to how much is it actually worth in the electricity system. So we have put it down to three aims, where the first one is to estimate the value of biomass in the electricity system under different availabilities and different emission targets, and to study which biomass-based technologies becomes important under these different perspectives. And finally, to investigate under which conditions bio-based technologies acts as complements or as competitors to variable renewable technologies. And to do this, we've used an energy system or electricity system model, where we optimize the investment and how the plants are run from a greenfield, so without the current system in place. We assume no net emissions, and we have a high temporal resolution in order to capture the variations from wind and solar mainly, at the same time as including several ways to manage the variations, such as demand-side management from households, batteries, electrolysis and fuel cells, and together with hydrogen storage, as the flexibility measures. And we've looked at it for three different European regions. So Ireland, in order to see how it works out with a very windy system. Spain, which from a European perspective has very good solar conditions. And then Hungary, to look at it for a country which neither have good solar or wind conditions. And we look at it in four cases. We have a base case where we have zero emissions, and we include all the flexibilities and allow CCS and fossil fuels. We have a case where we forbid CCS and thereby ban all use of fossil fuels. And we have a case where we remove the storages, batteries, the hydrogen storage, and the demand-side management, in order to see how much these actually do for reducing the need for biomass. And then we'd look at a case where we want to go below zero, so we go for 10% negative emissions, in order to see how these BECCS units are integrated in the system. So in order to do this, look at the biomass potential in a general sense, we looked at stepwise with the amount of biomass as a share. So the biomass fuel energy allowed in the electricity system is divided by the total annual demand of electricity. So 100% biomass availability would need 100% electrical efficiency in order to be able to fulfill the electricity demand. So, and going in then to look at the results, we can see that when we run this for lots of different biomass availabilities for the three regions, we get the biomass value or the willingness to pay for the biomass. And it's when you go to the really low availabilities, the willingness to pay grows pretty high even in the electricity system, due to its high value as a flexibility measure for the integration of wind and solar. And then it goes down pretty sharp, down to a stable level where the biomass usage efficiency starts to go down and then slowly continue down. Looking further into these, so in this high value area where we could say that this biomass is more needed, in the beginning we have lots of hydrogen storage in the really, really beginning in order to be able to satisfy the worst hours. When you go down, more to the right, we get some batteries, and in the biomass is actually only used in BECCS units in order to open up an emission space for natural gas. So, and then going into the second phase, that's where we don't need any more of this flexibility. So every new unit of biomass coming into the system is used to replace the BECCS and the fossil fuels. So going into a more renewable system. And then after this flat plateau, we go into this phase where it's only biomass and renewables in variable renewables in the system. And that's where the price, the value of the biomass goes so low because it's just replacing wind and solar. Then looking at the different cases, we get that if we don't allow this to use the negative emissions from the biomass in order to open up for any fossil fuels, we don't get as high value for the biomass in the beginning. But due to this lower flexibility efficiency of the biomass, we get to keep the value higher, or we don't want to keep the value high, but it's kept high for a larger availability of biomass before going into the base case. Looking at the case with less flexibility or without demand side management, batteries or hydrogen storage, we get the peak values are actually up at about 300. Doesn't say very much the actual value, but it's a lot higher, and it goes down, but a bit slower. And so we get some help from the flexibilities, but not maybe as much as we would expect. And then looking at the case where we go for negative emissions, of course we need some biomass available built just to fix the constraint. But in order to look at the how we shift it in order to see how it actually varies, and it's got a very similar shape to the base case. So the actual integration of BECCS neither helps nor makes the system more complicated. But of course, if the biomass availability is somewhere in this low region, then of course the BECCS will increase the value of the biomass and makes the system more difficult to fix. And looking into the variable renewables, As we see in the slow part where we have this really high value for biomass, biomass helps the variable renewable integration a lot in Spain and Hungary. And the rest of the system is usually filled with nuclear power. And we can see that they go up, and the nuclear is what is pretty much replaced by the biomass, natural gas, as well as the variable renewables. Before we go into this flat area where biomass is just replacing itself mainly, and then into the third phase where the variable renewables are outcompeted again. So what can change these results, since like one of the major things is that we only looked at the one region at a time, so including this into a transmission model could reduce the need for complementing variable renewables for in all these stages at the low biomass availability, so moving it towards zero. Also a lower cheaper hydrogen storages and hydrogen technologies overall could reduce the peaking values at the really low availability, and then increasing the efficiency of the biomass use by, for example, cheaper CCS technologies or improved efficiencies of these, capturing more of it, could move us towards the zero on the horizontal axis. And to finish this, I would like to give you four main conclusions, and some of these are maybe more too prescriptive. Looking back to the last panel words. So the biomass may have a very high value in the electricity system if the biomass availability is lower than 20% of the annual energy need. So somewhere low. And we also see that the regulating only the emissions in the electricity system gives you a large dependency on BECCS together with natural gas plants. As long as the demand availability is low or the price is high for other reasons. At low biomass availability, access to additional biomass has a strong impact on the share of wind and solar. As we could see, they are really important to have this flexible generation for the low wind and solar hours. And if the when the electricity production in BECCS units are driven by a need to achieve negative emissions, that may reduce the cost optimal share of wind and solar if we are in the low availability region. Thank you.
Thank you very much.